Good morning, dear students. I hope you all are keeping well. Today we will continue the story Lemon, Yellow and Fig.
But she had paid no money, and when the shopkeeper pointed out her mistake, she had called in a police and complained that she had just given 100 rupee note, and the shopkeeper, which had yet put in the cash box, and that he refused to give her the change. Oh yes, she knew the number of the note, and right enough, the number tallied with that on the note in the cash box. There was little that the shopkeeper could do about it except hand it the note over to her. It all seemed to fit. It was a dirty trick, but it had worked. And now they seem to be trying it out to me. Now he was thinking that this how they had tricked that man, that other shopkeeper. The lady had called the police and told that this number notes are there in his box, and that note I have given. Now the shopkeeper had nothing but to return the money. So this salesman was thinking that these two ladies are trying to do that same trick on him. It gave me a shock to think that anyone as pretty as my first customer should be involved in this kind of business. But this was no time to be worrying about it. I had to be quick if I was not going to be caught out. Now this salesman thought that the previous lady was very beautiful and she shouldn't be doing such things. But he said, but this is not the time to think of all these things. I need to take a precaution. Excuse me a moment. I told the lady who was looking intently at the fig colored saris, I have a few more in the same shade. I will get them for you. Now he told the lady that he has some more saris, but not here in the shop, so he will get it for her. The cash box was on the table in the corner, hidden from her view by a tall shelf. I opened it and took out the 100 rupee note given to me by the lady who came before her. Now what the salesman did, he went quietly at the cash box, took out that 100 rupee note from the cash box without showing it to this lady. I put it in my envelope and addressed the envelope to my brother, who worked in a shop hardly a couple of hundred yards away, and calling the boy from the next shop who did occasional jobs for me. I casually handed the envelope. Please take this to Kripa Ram's shop and give it to my brother, I told. Now what the salesman did it, he called a boy from the next shop who did some small jobs for this salesman, and he gave an envelope to him to put that money in that and said, go and give it to my brother who works nearby. Then please, with myself and smiling, I took three of those fig colored saris from another rack and went back to my customer. I would have been away from her for more than a minute. Now he took out some saris from here and there and went and showed her that these are the another fresh stock. She liked those saris a lot. She kept on looking at two of them as though she couldn't make up her mind which she liked better. I could scarcely keep myself from grinning at her play acting. Why don't you buy both? They should suit you equally well, I said to her. Yes, I think I will do that, she said with a broad smile. Now the lady was confused between two saris, and the shopkeeper advised her, why don't you take both the saris? And he was a little surprised on seeing that how well that lady was acting. So the lady said, okay, yes, I will take both the saris. She took both the saris and paid for them 90 rupees. She paid it all in 10 rupee notes. I looked at the notes carefully. I wondered if this was a new angle of the old tricks. But there was nothing wrong with the notes. It was clear that I had judged her wrongly. Now this lady gave her 90 rupees change very nicely. And the salesman was a little surprised. He was doubting that maybe this is a new trick, what they are trying on me. But then he checked the notes. Everything was perfectly fine. I felt a little ashamed of myself, but I had reasons to be pleased with myself too. I had made two good sales within half an hour of opening. And as soon as the boy returned, I sent him for a cup of coffee. Now, this salesman was very happy that he was not cheated and he had done a good sale today with three saris. And as soon as that boy returned, he sent him for a cup of coffee. And then I saw Mr. Ratnam coming towards the shop. I didn't even know he was in Bombay. He lives in Bangalore and looks after the looms. He was looking pleased as punch as he entered the shop, and when he sat down, I told him how well the shop was running and that more stocks would be needed almost immediately. Now, as this lady went, Mr. Ratnam entered the shop, and the salesman did not even know, he was not prepared that Mr. Ratnam is here in Bombay because he usually lives in Bangalore. So he was a little surprised, and well, he started giving him the report that everything is good, the shop is running well, and that now recently we will be needing a new fresh stock because the sales are going on very good. You can have all the stock you want, my boy, he said. That's what the shop is here for. So sell as much as we can. It's just that I wanted to make sure that I was not going to be let down like the I was for your visitors. Now he said that okay, you can have new stock as much as stock you want, but only thing is I just wanted to confirm that I will not be let down by your previous salesman, the person who was whom I had hired before you. I was rather hurt that he should be still doubtful of my honesty. I said, I was hoping you would be sure of me by now, sir. Now this salesman says, the writer says that I was doubting that by now, sir, you must be sure of my honesty. In business, in this sort of business, one can never take anything for granted, he said. There are so many temptations. What the last man used to do was to show that the sold fewer saris that he actually did and pocket the difference. It could never be found out unless there was a stock checking. Now Mr. Ratnam told, this is a business, and in business it is very difficult to trust anybody. He says, in the previous salesman also, it was very difficult to trust him, because what he did is, he used to sell the saris and he could not be caught unless and until the checking of the stock was done. He used to sell the saris and the difference money he used to keep in his pocket. So unless and until there was stock checking, he could not be caught. So he came for a surprise stock checking. I see, I said. I just wanted to check the stocks before sending you any more. Just a formality. You know, you don't mind, do you? Now Mr. Ratnam says, I just wanted to check the previous stock before I could send you more fresh stock. It was nice of him to ask me if I minded, but of course I didn't mind. Now he was little relaxed. Okay, it was good enough that the owner is asking him that whether he would feel bad about it, checking the stock or no. For most of the next hour, we did a sort of courtesy, curiosity stock taking. Now for some time they were doing the checking of the stock. In fact, I did most of the actual checking, and if I had needed to, I could have easily given Mr. Ratnam fictitious figures. I was satisfied that all the stock was absolutely correct to the last jolly piece. Now this salesman is saying that if I wanted, I could give him wrong figures, but he himself helped Mr. Ratnam to check the stock. Each and every piece was checked perfectly and the stock was perfect. However, even before I had quite finished counting, Mr. Ratnam called out to me. I think that will do, he said. I am entirely satisfied with you. As soon as I get back, I will send you more pieces, and from next month, you had better take on someone to assist you. A little boy to do the running about. Now Mr. Ratnam said, okay, that's all, we are okay, I am okay with everything is fine, and I will send you the fresh stock, and from next week you hire a small boy who can assist you, help you out with some odd jobs running about here and there. Mr. Ratnam paused for a moment and gave me a broad smile. Then he said, I am particularly pleased with your ways of dealing with customers. I wanted to be personally satisfied about that. So this morning I sent my daughter and sister to make or two or odds purchases. It seemed that although you had just opened the shop, you managed to change a 100 rupee note for my daughter. There is nothing more annoying than being kept waiting for change. I also like the way you sold my sister two saris when she had come with the idea of buying one. They were full of praise of you. Now, let us just check the cash box and I will have done with you. A mere formality, you know. You don't be having much more in it than you 100 rupee and that what my daughter and sister paid. Now, Mr. Ratnam says, okay. I just wanted to test you and I had sent my daughter and my sister to test you and they were very happy, they were praising you. My daughter was the first customer and she gave you 100 rupees note and you had the change. You did not make her wait for the change. And even my sister, she came with the mind to purchase one sari and you sold her two saris. It was really very happy. Now let me check the cash box. Now in your cash box you should have just the amount what my sister had given, that 100 rupee note. Otherwise you are okay with it. I am sure my heart skipped a bit. I suddenly dawned upon me that there was a whole 100 rupee note missing from the box, and Mr. Ratnam noticed it too as soon as he snapped the lid open. Now the salesman was a little scared because a note was missing. He had sent it to his brother. As soon as Mr. Ratnam opened the box, he understood that the money is missing. And that was how I lost my job. I didn't even try to explain. I just stared blankly at him and at the box alternatively. I was sure that no explanation I could give would have convinced him. He did not have any sort of mind. What he recognized was the cold fact that 100 rupee was missing. Now this salesman, this writer, he did not even explain Mr. Ratnam what happened. Because he could not convince him. So he said there was no point in explaining. And that is how he had lost his job. Anyway, I couldn't tell him that I had taken his daughter and his sister for a pair of confidence trickers if had I this word. Now he says, I could not even tell Mr. Ratnam that he has suspected his daughter and his sister as trickers who came to trick him. He shook his head from side to side and he looked sad when he said to me, and you have such an honest face. Of course I am honest, but I am out of words, and if you know anyone who needs a keen young salesman. Now Mr. Ratnam is telling him that I do not know, I cannot believe it, but you have a really very honest face. Now the salesman is thinking to himself, yes, I am honest, but the only thing is I do not have words to explain. And again, there he was on the road looking out for another job as a salesman. With this, we have finished the chapter and I will be sending you the question answers in the group.